It's cool, you know, no touch screen or nothing. It's like this really old school shit.
So you don't like touch screen compared to that one?
Well, you know, there's just too much stuff on the phone nowadays. That
so you can just show one of your favorites.
The classic.
Yeah, use this one. Know this. Yeah, blah blah blah.
This one, because it doesn't work if you have a wet finger or whatever. It doesn't work. This one works. This doesn't break.
There's a lot of plans in the air, but nothing concrete.
But so far you have toured. How was that?
It was good. We started from Finland when the album came out. I think that was... Now I can't even remember.
Last year you recorded that.
Yes, we did. Yeah, we recorded that one in Astia Studio.
Yeah.
Lappeenranta.
Why did you choose the Astia Studio? How did it come?
Well, it actually came a little bit by accident, since we were kind of like too late for when it comes to booking studios. So all the studios around Helsinki area was already completely booked for that time what we wanted to have for the recordings. So then I was like, well, we could go to Lappeenranta. It's only like 2 hours drive.
So you had known about that before?
Yeah, I've been there with my former band, Norther, about, I don't know, 5 times, something like that.
Yeah.
So I already know the guy, and...
Like the sound?
That one too. And he's an amazing man when it comes to that one. He's always checking out new stuff, how to use different recording methods and all kind of weird stuff what he has at the studio. So so in the end, all the studios were booked over here, so we kind of had to go outside Helsinki, and we tried on Sikippo. He said, yeah, I'm available. I'm like, cool. So we come there.
All right. Why a one-man army? Why is it called that way? I mean, is it something personal for the guy who named it that?
No, not really. I think it was like the most catchiest name what we came up with. Like,
by the way, about the cover, who did it? I mean, how do you usually do that cover work? Do you give the music to someone? And
not really. We usually give like the ideas what we would like to have on the cover, and then the artist can work with that one. So it's like back and forth, once, twice a week when you get the first sketch. Then like, okay, this needs to be changed over here, and the color's a little bit darker or lighter and all that, small details. So, and the guy is from, I think he was from Hungary.
Oh, okay.
Hungarian guy, and I don't know how many thousands of emails were sent back and forth with that one, but the list is like super long. Probably the longest email conversation between the band and somebody ever. There was always coming something. Then we wanted a little bit more of this one, more of that one, and he made the changes, sent another one, and then we're like, I think the previous one was better, so can you switch it back and all that.
By the way, about vocals, when did you feel like you like to harsh, to sing harsh vocals? What age? Like?
I think it was when I was, I think around 16.
So you were like a school graduate? Or about like that?
Yeah, about that one. Like 15, 16, something like that.
Did you do something at school? Like, started to play there or somehow?
Well, I got my first guitar when I was maybe 10 or 11. But then I really started to play guitar when I was 14. So...
You came into that seriously?
Yeah. And before that one, I wanted to start playing drums. But thank God I did not.
Why?
That's too much work. I see our drummer in every single rehearsals or whatever, you know. He's sweating his ass off, and we're not.
Did any of your family members listen to rock or rock and roll and somehow made it clear for you, no?
No.
Where the push come from?
This is an excellent question.
How did you feel it in the air that it is rock for Petri?
I think it came when I was in like 5th or 6th grade, and one of my childhood friends' big brother had like shitloads of CDs at home, and he had Slayer Seasons in the Abyss album over there, so we were digging that one, and especially track number 7, Skeletons of Society.
Now
that
we know.
Like, fuck, this is cool. And after that one came the guitars and all that one. So
now we have.
Probably was one of the first riffs when I ever learned how to play.
The Slayer.
Yeah.
Are you going to Slayer this time, or you are away from Helsinki in December? They are coming.
What date?
6th is Motorhead and 7th is Slayer and Anthrax and at the Gates.
Okay.
And after party at the Reef.
Yeah, sounds like a plan actually. Why not? Because I think I'm gonna be around that one since we got an offer.
Because
to
they
do one show.
Yeah.
Show in some part of Finland on the 11th. So I think I'm gonna be around. So yeah, sounds good.
Who are the bands which you like having a company with, especially like in spirit? In burping, I don't know.
Burping goes with pretty much any Finnish band. Somehow we Finnish people know that one pretty good. It kind of doesn't matter. We had very good time with At the Gates. These guys were also in Istanbul a couple of weeks ago. We played the last festival what was booked for us this summer. At the Gates was over there, and some other bands too. Moonspell was there also, so everybody was booked at the same hotel, so we saw after the festival was done at the roof bar over there on the 26th floor or something. You can see the whole Istanbul from
there. Okay.
It was nice hanging out, you know, just changing
clothes.
No, not those ones. Thank God. But like, you know, stories. It's also nice to hear that not everything goes so well.
Okay.
Always with all the other bands. Always think, since, you know, all these festivals, you're flying out to, I don't know, Germany somewhere. From the airport, you have like 3-4 hours drive to the festival, and you're sitting in traffic. You got nothing to do, and everything is just shit, and you're tired, and you're hungry, and all that one. It's nice to hear that everybody else has the same problem.
After going to Austria for like living, is there anything Finnish in your house, in your place? Besides you, of course.
Besides me, yes. I was actually just sending some ruisleipä back at home.
From Oulu, or ruisleipä, what is the company? Vaasa.
Vaasa and also Oululainen Reissumies.
That's the best.
Some real bread.
The best one.
Because, you know, ruisleipä, you can only get it from here. Even if you go to Sweden, they don't have the same shit that we do. Ruisleipä. It's the best bread in the world. Ruisleipä and lonkero. You can survive with that one.
In Austria, you live like more to the border of, closer to the border of, with Germany or?
Closer to Slovenia. The place is actually very nice where I'm living over there. It's called Klagenfurt. It's like this Kuopio Mikkeli sized.
Those traditional ones.
Yeah, the Alps are actually not that far away. What starts to go to the more to the east.
Have you been there?
No, actually no. Since I don't do like any skiing or snowboarding.
No, just walking.
It will be nice, but you
far away from assholes like me.
Yeah. I would like to go to walk over there, but you know, you would need a couple of days to actually make a trip, because you know, all the hills are like this. They're fucking steep. You need to be like mountain climber if you want to go and take a walk over there. Totally different than from Finnish nature, where we have small hills. Actually, we don't have anything similar to a mountain.
Let's ask Petri about his school years. I was also always wondering how a schoolboy could develop into a harsh voice of Ensiferum and stuff like that. Kind of a rebel, or
yeah, I don't know. tried always to be the cool kid, you know, making jokes on school, like at the classroom.
On the principal, on the director.
We were in very good relationship, you know. We talked almost daily. There was always something that he thought that I should not do in school. Don't fucking do this, don't do that. I'm like, you know, boys are boys. I think nowadays it's still the same thing, you know. All the little bit cooler kids, they need to push their luck. Like, how far can you go? And all that.
After school, what did you do?
I went to the School of Economics.
Yeah? Almost there.
Yeah, that was in Leppävaara, in Espoo. And, well, needed to figure out something. I actually didn't want to go anywhere after getting out from the ninth grade, you know.
That's natural.
Like, yeah. So I'm like, I'm fine. But mom was like convincing me that you need to go and study something more. Like, sure, why not? And well, I was there for 1 year. And then came summer holidays and I never went back. So I'm like, fuck that.
You took a guitar and went away.
My thing. Yeah. The band was just starting up back at that time. We were 17, 18 at that time. So, you know, we wanted to start drinking since we were legally allowed to drink. So we could go to the ass market and buy our own beer, party on. And yeah, the band was very cool. We played a lot, like 4 or 5 times a week, having beers with the same time. And, well, then it was time to make the choice to go to the army or not.
And so, you decided to go to one man army.
I decided to go to one man army. So I did the civil service of that one. And it is, I think it's probably still 13 months in Finland. And there's the 1 month, like this educational month in Lapinjärvi. If anybody is a civil service dude knows what I'm talking about. And the 1 month over there, we were at beginning of January. Fucking cold. Like, seriously.
Like 30?
It was, yeah, like 25-ish.
Where is it located?
It's
like Lapland.
No. Lapinjärvi, it's a couple of hours drive from here.
Ah.
Yeah. But it was like, the pickup from Helsinki city center to that one was like 7 in the morning or something. So you arrive over here in January, it's pitch black and it's fucking cold and you have no idea where you're going and everybody is like long haired with leather jackets and all that, you know.
So Dark Funeral is a good soundtrack to that landscape.
Yeah, we were just doodling the song Into the Unknown from Merciful Fate on our drive to there.
Like, I see you like King Diamond.
Yes. So. That was a big hit at that point. And it was cool. 1 month over there. And I got myself a job since you need to have like a where you're gonna do the 12 months, let's say you're in a school or in a daycare center. So I was at Pohjois-Tapiola, the daycare center over there for a year playing with 3 to 6 year old kids. I was playing with them, playing some cards, doing some drawings and
making
some
bets.
Yeah, playing some hockey outside and, you know, taking walks and stuff like that. Going to some kids' theater shows and all that cool stuff. It was absolutely fantastic. Well, there's a lot of cool stuff happening. Probably not at the moment, not so cool, but afterwards it's making people laugh a lot more.
Something that you, when you remember, makes you laugh a bit or smile.
Yeah, there's a lot of those ones. For example, on 2004, we played with Fintroll and the band called The Wake. Three Finnish bands on 4 weeks European tour. That was absolutely alcoholic thing. We played a show in Innsbruck, so we drove overnight. We arrived in the morning and I woke up and I really needed to take a shit. Like, I mean now. There's no time to
wait.
To wait or go outside and look for a gas station or whatever, since I assumed that the venue is still closed because it was very early in the morning. And well, luckily the door was open. I go in and it's like this huge mess hall, like thousands of cubic meters of empty space on left and right, and like 200 meters that way is a cleaning lady doing something, and I'm screaming my ass off like, toilet, and she points that direction. I started to run, and after like 5 minutes of running that way, I found it some backstage area over there and found a toilet. There was three right next to each other, so
I hope one of them was for males, boys.
Yes,
toilet.
This was men's toilet, so there was three, and okay. I picked the middle one. I went in
the golden middle
and I did my thing, and I sat over there for a while and just enjoyed the moment because it felt so fucking
good. The silence.
Yes,
when
you can release the pressure.
Yeah, a feeling of deep satisfaction.
Yes, deep satisfaction. And then it comes to the time when you need to wipe your butt. And I'm like, okay, no toilet paper.
I can guess.
So, what now? Well, there's one on the left, one on the right. Go to the
long
left.
Way.
Go on the left. Sit down on the toilet. Check it out. Shit. Empty. Back to the third one. Check it out. Empty. No toilet paper.
So what did you use?
I went back to the middle. All three booths are out of toilet paper. So I go back to the where the shit is already in the toilet. So I'm sitting over there, and it was time when the cell phones were just like coming to a big hit. So I had this old Nokia with me.
A brick, kind of.
Yeah, the legendary, like this 3-5, was it like 2-0, whatever. So I'm like, okay, I'm gonna call somebody to the bus and ask them to bring some toilet paper for me over here.
Logical.
Yeah, go figure, everybody has been drinking so fucking much, nobody's picking up the phone. Like the all 20 people who I called, nobody's answering. So I'm like, okay, now comes the tricky part. How do I survive from this situation? So the only option what I got was to use my socks. I used them well.
Did you have these sporty socks?
No,
which
they
are short,
were long ones.
Or
long
traditional
ones.
Ones.
So, yeah, so there was like,
that's good.
About 3 or 4 wipes per sock. Depends how you fold it. It's a little bit tricky, but if that is your only option, I'm pretty sure everybody can manage that one.
Be attentive, it's advice from Petri. Yeah.
Experience from touring. All kind of situation.
So it worked well.
So I used the socks and I put them to the trash. Mm-hmm. I did not put them to the toilet because that would be an epic fail, because then it gets blocked. And when you flush it, and then you have all the shit coming out from over there.
Yeah.
And you have to remember that you need to spend the whole day at that same toilet. So you would be shooting your own leg with that kind of stupid move. Yeah, but that is one of the great moments.
What would you say inspires you most for music? You know, like you feel like, now I give them hell. Something. Just people. And maybe some cases or some music or whatever.
It's actually, it really, really depends on the day, you know. Some
just
days,
take any day which you have experience.
Like for example, on tour, when you play like 30 shows, you know, it's hard to make it really, really enjoyable for every single evening.
I can imagine.
Some nights you just have the feeling like, okay, 10 minutes to showtime, and you're like, I just wish that I could go back to bed, you know, and just start over tomorrow. Maybe tomorrow is a better day, but in most of the cases like that one, it always changes when you go on stage. Like, you know, the audience is all fucking excited and, you know, screaming your band's name and all that one. It's, then you're like, all right, it's gonna be a good evening. You know, the sound is okay on stage. You can,
so that changes that mood.
It changes the mood, like in
from
like
downfall
this.
To uprising.
Yeah. And then you have also these totally opposite moments when you start to have some fucked up technical problems in the beginning of the show, And you check out like, okay, there's still an hour and 30 minutes to go with this same fucking bullshit. And you need to pretend that you're enjoying the show on stage, you know.
You mean some kind of problems with sound?
Problems with, you know, it doesn't matter who has the problem because
it
usually always stops the whole show.
Yeah.
So that one is really annoying. But like, get in the good mood, you know, sometimes it only needs just really small things nowadays. Doesn't need to be anything big. Like fucking nice day for a change. You know, sun is shining like now and it's not raining.
Simple things in life.
Simple things in life. When you get older, you start to appreciate that one.
Look, if you are asked to participate in a movie, like a normal, usual movie in a cinema, what would that be about and what would character, your character would be? Like Evil One or those that save fucking world every time.
Yeah, the hero, dude.
Yeah.
I don't know. Maybe some real badass dude would be cool, you know. Since on the real life we need to be so all behaving good all the time and, you know, that people don't write any bad reviews on Facebook and all that shit, you know. Everybody needs to be on their best behavior all the time. Nowadays it's not cool anymore if you trash a backstage, because then you will never play in that venue again. And
that
is not good.
Yeah, it's bullshit.
Yeah. So it was cool at the 80s. Now the 2000 something, it's
pretty honest.
Yeah, it's not that cool anymore. People don't like it when you break their stuff.
When you say what how could you compose such a
You know, since nowadays it's so easy to people to write, like, you know, you make a mistake on some part of a song. Before that song is done, people can post it already online. He fucked that up. He fucked that up. Oh, he fucked that one up too, you know. So all the shit what you do or say is immediately online. This was actually from a speech from the guitar player of Twisted Sister, what I saw last summer. They played a fucking excellent show in Austria, in Graz. And he had this little monologue in between the songs and he was opening up a little bit about that one. And he said, like, back in the days, you know, when these guys started, they've been around 30 years now. So when you made a mistake, it might have took like shortest like 2-3 weeks before it was published in a magazine. Now before you even finish the sentence, somebody can post it already. So it's like
immediate.
They fucked up. You know, it's
you know, I'm a one-man magazine, so it will take like 3 weeks to publish you. So.
Yeah.
You can still find that old school good
stuff. I can.
Can you tell something in German? How long have you been living there, like in Austria?
It's this December. It's coming like 6 years. But I've been over there about half since we've been pretty busy touring. So.
So when you come to a nearest shop, what do you say? You don't say, kiitos, olle hyvä.
I can, but they don't.
Yeah, you
know
can. But they can't.
I'm really lazy when it comes to like learning new languages, for example. Should I say?
Yeah, you know that. That's good.
Dankeschön is very, very good.
That's too much cultural.
And also, what I wanted to check out, like German in the language, it's very, very, very unlogical. Because they, for example, numbers, when it comes to 1 to 10, 1 to 20. And then from 20 up, you have 21, 22. But they say the singular responds
20.
First and then the tens.
21.
That is 21. Why?
Why not 21?
Yeah, 21. Yeah, that would make sense. But they twist it around, and when you have like the bigger numbers you get,
the more
fucking
shit.
More confusing it is. You know, when you have like, let's say, 814 euros and 67 cents, they say the cents first, and then the big actual, the hundred numbers. And I'm like, Here's my credit card. Put it on that one because I have no idea what you just said. Or when I go to the food shop, I try to always be on that kind of position that I can see the numbers on the
score, same with me here.
Scoreboard that I know how much it is.
The same with me here. I just give 100.
Yeah, give 100.
If you, I have, of course.
Always go with the big bill, even if you buy one bottle of Coke Zero over there, which is like 2 euros. Give a 50. Just to be on the safe side.
To be sure. Yeah,
that it doesn't get embarrassing because you gave too less money. Yeah, but it's very unlogical language. It just doesn't fit to my head.
Do you like some German or, I don't know, Austrian, but German bands, maybe like those kind of Tankard or Tom Angel Ripper from Sodom? kind of guys.
Sodom guys are cool. We've been a couple of times drinking them in. It was in Ireland.
Ireland?
Quite it was far away. Funny. We shared a backstage with them. It was awesome. Awesome experience also. We also have some kind of relationship with Tankard, since these guys are absolutely in love with beer.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think you know that one.
Chemical invasion.
Who stole my beer? Yeah, and well, that actually happened to us. These guys played before us in, I don't know, some small German festival, and we shared the backstage, and also there's like two fridges right next to each other, ours and Tankard. Both is filled with beer, so these guys went on, they took like half of the beer on stage with them, and they come off, we go on, we come back, our fridge is empty too. And these guys have left. They stole our fucking beer. We were like, fuck, that is rude. They did not even leave like 5 that we could each get one beer. They took all. They left only the milk, you know.
They cared of your health.
Yeah, like fucking dickheads. Like seriously. Payback is a bitch when we get the chance, you know. And then it took like a couple of years because we're always playing at the same festival but different days. So we kind of like started leaving notes like, guys, where's our beer? And then it was probably last year or before in the festival, the singer of Tango came to a backstage and he brought us a case of beer. He's like, really sorry about that one, but here's the beer back.
After that story, any question is a dumb one. What's happening right now in the camp of Ansipharum these days?
We're just getting ready for going to Poland next week. We have 3 shows over there. Warsaw, Krakow and Wrocław. 3 shows on October 1, 2, 3. And just checking out the set for that one, and also just taking a sneak peek for future material, also new songs. Have some little bits here and there, checking out what we can make out of that one. And then in the middle of October, we're gonna go to 2 weeks like around Spain area. Start from Switzerland, one show in Zurich, and then Spain all around.
Are you going to get some sun on the beach there?
If it's sunny and warm still, why not? Yeah.
Yeah?
Yes.
Congrats.
Thank you.
There is place for leaving messages to Anssi Kipo and Markus van Hala, because I will send it to them. Or you can, right now.
Ei mitään sinne Lappeenrantaan vaan hirveästi terveisiä. Me halutaan tulla takas saunomaan. Ja sitten tekee se seuraava lätty kans sit joskus. Ja Hale ja Pusui takas. Ja sitten Markus Van Halenille vaan terveisiä, että lisää keikkaa vaan ja double shifti on aina jees.
Pussi pussi.
Pussi pussi, moi.
So, okay, Petri, thank you. Kiitos paljon.
Thank you very much for
your great response.
Thank you.
You are a real Viking man. Just one last question. No, it always is in my mind, I couldn't sleep.
Yeah.
When the next album is coming out, and what are songs about?
This is what we do to people who ask that fucking question.
All good. No animals were hurt on this stunt.